have seen that one of the relatively easy way of showing that a function is integrable, either Riemann integrable or Riemann still disintegrable, is the one criteria which we discussed last time, and that is the following. That okay, let me rewrite it. That is, we have shown that f is integrable, that is R a b alpha, if and only if for every epsilon bigger than 0 there exists a partition P in the script P, such that for this particular partition u p f alpha minus l p f alpha is less than epsilon. And using this, we have shown that every continuous function is Riemann integrable, and also with a slight modification of the same proof, we observed that every continuous, whenever alpha is any monotonically increasing function, every continuous function is also Riemann still just integrable, right. And the main tool used there was, if you remember, that every continuous function defined on such a closed and bounded interval is uniformly continuous, and using that we subdivided the partition in a particular way. Okay, for continuous functions we can also notice one more thing. Okay, in fact we have noticed that whatever be the partition, this part is always true, that is l p f alpha, this is always less than or equal to u p f alpha. Then we also observed, okay, let me keep this is less than or equal to any Riemann still just sum, and this is less than or equal to upper sum, and this upper sum is less than or equal to big M into alpha b minus alpha a, and this lower sum is always bigger than or equal to small m into alpha b minus alpha a, where as usual this small m and big M have the same meaning which we have discussed earlier, namely that big M is the supremum of fx over the interval and small m is the infimum. What we also know is that whenever the function is integrable, the upper and lower integrals coincide, okay, and upper integral is the infimum of the upper sums, and so it will be always less than or equal to any upper sum. Similarly, lower integral is the supremum of the lower sums, so it is bigger than or equal to any lower sum. So both these numbers, lower integral as well as the upper integral, they lie between any of the lower sum and the upper sum, and in particular when the function is integrable, the number integral is nothing but the common value, because we say that function is integrable is same as saying that the upper integral is same as the lower integral. So that common number will also lie between these two, always common, no, not these two, this and this, this and this. Okay, so what we can observe here is that okay, let me write it once again here. If f is integrable, that is if f is this or a b alpha, then we can say this, that is this is less than or equal to integral a to b f d alpha, and this is less than or equal to integral, no, this is less than or equal to u p f alpha, and we already seen that this is less than or equal to big M into alpha b minus alpha a, and this is bigger than or equal to small m into alpha b minus alpha a. Okay, and usually this function alpha will be a strictly monotonically increasing function, so alpha b minus alpha a will be strictly bigger than 0 in most cases, unless in some very trivial examples. So what one can say further is the following. Okay, that is, I can say that this small m is less than or equal to 1 by alpha b minus alpha a into integral a to b f d alpha, and this is less than or equal to big M. Okay, this much is true for any integrable function, right. This, if the function is continuous, we can say something more. Okay, and what is that? This big M is a supremum. Okay, and we know that if the function is continuous, on this interval, then this value is attained. That means there is some point, let us say the point x1, such that f at x1 is equal to m, right. Similarly, there is some point, let us say x2, such that f at x2 is m, okay. That means these values small m and big m are taken, actually taken by the function, right. And if the function is continuous, we know that if it takes any two values, it will take all the values which lie in between those two, the famous intermediate value theorem. So that means what? That means there should be some point at which the function takes this value also, right? That will happen if a function is continuous. Okay. So let us just see what is the consequence of that. So if f is also continuous, continuous on AB, then there exists a point C in this interval AB such that what should happen? That is 1 by alpha B minus alpha A into this. This is same as C, okay. That is 1 by alpha B minus alpha A into integral A to B F D alpha. This is equal to C, not C, this is equal to F at C, right, because there exists some point C at which the function F takes the value given by this, okay. That is F of C is equal to this number, okay. Or what is same as saying that, suppose we rewrite the same thing in a different manner, that is integral A to B f d alpha, that is same as f at c multiplied by alpha b minus alpha a, okay. And this statement that whenever f is continuous, there exists c in AB satisfying this last, okay, that is called the first mean value theorem of integral calculus, okay. That is called the first mean value theorem of integral. What is the theorem? That if f is continuous, see, once it is continuous, it is automatically integrable. That is what we have already shown. Then there exists C such that integral A to B f d alpha is equal to f c into alpha b minus alpha a. That is called first mean value theorem. Okay, we'll use the standard short form for mean value. First mean value theorem of integral calculus. By mean value theorem, because it looks very similar to mean value theorems of differential calculus, okay. It talks about some point C inside the interval AB such that something happens at that point, okay. And why first? Obviously, it means something is going to follow, okay. Something, some more theorems are going to follow, okay. That's why first, okay. But anyway, it will not happen immediately, after some time, okay. All right. So that is about these continuous functions. There is one more class of functions in case of which we can prove in a straightforward manner that those functions are integrable, and those are monotonic functions, okay. So that is another theorem that we want to say. Let us, as usual, just as we have done in case of continuous functions, we shall first prove for Riemann integrals, and then we will go to this arbitrary Riemann-Stieltjes integral. So if f is monotonic on AB, then f is, of course, we are always assuming that this function alpha is okay. For the time being, I am not talking about alpha. Then f is Riemann integrable. Okay, let me write in words. Then f is Riemann integrable on AB. Now, what happens if f is monotonic? Okay, f is monotonic means what? It is either monotonically increasing or monotonically decreasing. Let us prove in one of the cases. Proof in the other case will be similar. Okay, so assume f is monotonically increasing. Okay. In order to know what is happening in this case, see, the first thing that we can observe here is that what we have defined, let us recall the definitions of this big Mi and small Mi. Okay. That is, this big, what was this big Mi? Big Mi was nothing but supremum of fx, where x belongs to this ith subinterval xi minus 1 to xi. Okay. But we know that f is protonically increasing. So what can we say about this big Mi? For an increasing function on an interval, what will be the maximum value? Value that it takes at the right hand end point. Okay. So this is nothing but f of xi, right? F of xi. Similarly, small Mi, that is nothing but infimum of the same, and that will be nothing but f at xi minus 1, right? F at xi minus 1, okay? Right? Okay. Now, for any such partition, suppose we look at the difference between the upper sum and lower sum. Since we are talking about the Riemann sums, let us just look at UPF minus LPF. Okay, so this will be nothing but sigma I going from 1 to n. Sigma I going from 1 to n. It will be nothing but f xi minus f xi minus 1 multiplied by delta xi. Okay. Right? And delta xi is nothing but xi minus xi minus 1, okay, all right. Now, suppose I choose a partition in such a way that this delta xi is constant, okay. Suppose I choose a partition in such a way that this delta xi is constant. If the delta xi is constant, then there is only one possible value. If there are n sub intervals, each must be of length 1 by n, okay. So choose a partition in such a way, okay, that n we shall choose later, okay, but first we will say that if there are, so choose p such that, delta xi is, see, there are n sub intervals, and if each interval is, has to be of the same length and the total length is b minus a, so each of the delta xi must be b minus a by n, okay, so each of the delta xi must be b minus a by n. Okay, and so what will be the partition? That is also easy to say. We know that A is x naught, then x 1 will be nothing but a plus b minus a by n. That is x 1. X 2 will be a plus 2 times b minus a by n, etc. Okay. So in general, one can say that x I is equal to a plus I times b minus a by n. Choose this partition. Okay. So for this partition, what will happen to this UPF minus LPF? This delta xi is b minus a by n. So that will come outside the summation sign, okay? That will come outside the summation sign. So this is nothing but b minus a by n and multiplied by this sigma I going from 1 to n f xi minus f xi minus 1. Okay, so once the delta xi has come outside, what will remain? Suppose you take this sum. For example, first element will be fx1 minus fx0, second will be fx2 minus fx1, etc. Okay. So it will be simply f of xn minus fx0, nothing but fb minus fa. Okay, nothing but fb minus fa. Okay, so you can put that here, fb minus fa. So suppose you do that simplification, so what we get, this is UPF minus LPF. This is nothing but this b minus a divided by n and multiplied by fb minus fa. Okay. Okay, you can say then. Okay. Now come back to this criteria. What we said, that f is integrable if and only for every epsilon there exists a partition p such that up, in our case this alpha is just x, okay, so upf minus lpf is less than epsilon, okay, all right. Now in our case, what is upf minus lpf? It is b minus a fb, etc. Okay, there is only one thing that depends on the partition, and that is this number n. Everything else is fixed, okay. So the only question is this: given epsilon, can we choose n such that this whole thing becomes less than epsilon? That's obvious, right? Because we can make n sufficiently large so that this b minus a into this number is, suppose this number is fixed, suppose you call that number k, okay, this whole thing is k by n, okay, then choose n such that n is bigger than epsilon by k, okay, m is bigger than epsilon by k, then this difference will be less than epsilon, okay, and that means that f is Riemann integrable, right? F is Riemann integrable, okay, all right. Is this clear? Okay. Now coming back to Riemann-Stieltjes integrable, Riemann-Stieltjes integrality. See, one can do all these calculations up to this. Okay, this will be replaced by upf alpha minus lpf alpha. Okay, let me carry on here. Okay. Suppose instead of Riemann integrability, suppose I look at Riemann-Stieltjes integrability, okay, then this will not change, okay, big mi and small mi, those numbers depend only on f, okay. So if I look at this difference u p f alpha minus l p f alpha, this will be sigma I going from 1 to n, then multiplied by f, sorry, fxi minus fxi minus 1, and this is multiplied by, instead of delta xi, it will be delta alpha I, okay, it will be delta alpha I, okay. And what is delta alpha I? Recall delta alpha is nothing but alpha xi minus alpha xi minus 1, okay. So instead of delta xi there, we have delta alpha I here, okay, we have delta alpha I here, okay. And what was our next argument? We have said that we can choose a partition in such a way such that that delta xi is constant, okay, the delta xi, and that delta xi turned out to be, if it has to be constant, it has to be b minus a by n. So what will be the change here? We will want this delta alpha I to be alpha b minus alpha a divided by n, okay, delta alpha I should be alpha b minus alpha a divided by n. Now the whole question is whether, okay, that is, if we want to imitate that, we want this, okay, we want delta alpha I is equal to alpha b minus alpha a divided by n, okay. Okay, for example, suppose I look at, say, delta alpha 1. What is delta alpha 1? That is alpha 1 is nothing but alpha at x1 minus alpha at x0. This should be same as delta alpha b minus alpha a, alpha b minus alpha a divided by n, okay. Or what is the meaning? It means alpha x1 should be same as alpha x0 plus alpha b minus alpha a by n, okay. Now if you compare this situation here, it was easy to say that you just choose x1 such that x1 is a plus b minus a by n, okay, choose x1, x1 is nothing but a plus b minus a by n. But here what is the case? We want to choose x1 such that alpha x1 is equal to alpha x0 plus alpha b minus alpha a by n, okay. So the question is whether such an x1 exists or not, okay, whether the function alpha takes this value or not, okay. That is a question, okay, right. And in general, we all, only thing that we know about the function alpha is that it is monotonically increasing, okay. Only thing that we know is it is monotonically increasing, right, but we know nothing further, okay. But if we impose some additional condition, see, is it clear to you that alpha x1 that is anyway bigger than or equal to alpha? See, this is a since alpha is smaller, this is a non-negative number, okay? So this alpha x0 is less than this alpha x1, and this is obviously less than or equal to alpha b minus alpha a, okay? Or not alpha b minus a, this is, I can say, less than or equal to alpha b, okay? That's clear? Okay. All right. Because alpha, I can say that alpha b, alpha x naught is nothing but alpha a. Alpha x naught is nothing but, this is nothing but alpha a. Alpha a plus alpha b minus alpha a divided by n. Okay. And one can say that for any positive n, this will be less than or equal to alpha b minus alpha a, and then hence this whole thing will be less than or equal to alpha b. Okay. So if we knew that alpha is continuous, then we can say that it takes this value, so it will take all the intermediate values. So I can find x1 such that alpha at x1 is equal to this, okay? Otherwise we cannot say this, okay? Otherwise, so if we add the hypothesis of continuity to alpha, then I can say that I can choose alpha x1 in this fashion. Having chosen alpha x1, use the same technique, I can choose alpha x2 also in the same fashion. So if alpha is continuous, then we can choose the partition x not x1 x in such a way that each delta alpha satisfies this condition, okay? Otherwise you may or may not be able to do this, okay? So what it means is that this will work if you assume that f is monotonic, that alpha should be not only monotonic but also continuous. And that is, remember, that is true for Riemann integration case, because in case of Riemann integrals, alpha x is nothing but x, that is a continuous function, okay? So that is automatically satisfied here, okay? So we can say that if f is monotonic on AB, then f is Riemann integrable. Also, if alpha is continuous, then that means all this is assumed, f is monotonic, alpha is also monotonically increasing and continuous, then f belongs to this R A B alpha. Now we go to the another task, just as in case of differentiability, we order, if we know that a function is differentiable, then what can we, for example, suppose we know that f1 and f2 are differentiable, then f1 plus f2 is differentiable, and etc. A similar thing we want to do in case of integration, okay? That is, suppose we know that some functions are integrable, then constructing functions using those functions and whether those new functions are also integrable or not, that is the question that we are going to deal with now, okay? Right. So let me start with this, okay? So suppose this is a theorem, okay? Okay. So suppose f and g are in words, f and g are Riemann integrable with respect to some monotonically increasing function alpha, okay? Then okay, there are several statements we want to make. Okay, I shall write one by one and then we shall discuss the corresponding proofs also. All these proofs depend basically on the definition of integrability. Okay, okay, so first thing that we want to say is this one. F and G are also, sorry, F plus G. F plus G is also integrable. F plus g is also integrable, and we can say something more. Integral a to b f plus g d alpha. This is same as integral a to b f d alpha plus integral a to b g d alpha. okay, and second thing is, okay, f for g it is, suppose we take any k for every real number k in R, okay, for every real number k, k times f is also Riemann's tilde integrable. And integral a to b k f d alpha, this is same as k times integral a to b f d alpha. Okay, what does it mean inverse? That if you take two functions in this, if f and g are Riemann tilde integrable, then their sum as well as product with a constant is also integrable. Okay. In other words, since you are also doing a course in linear algebra simultaneously, it is basically same as saying that this is a real vector space. Okay, set of all Riemann tilde integrable, suppose alpha is kept fixed, then set of all Riemann tilde integrable functions is a vector space over real numbers. Okay. If you take all functions on AB, that is also a vector space. You can say this is a subspace of that. Okay. And what can we say about? Can we also describe this part in terms of linear algebra using terminology of linear algebra? Have you studied what is meant by a linear functional? Yes. Have you studied what is meant by linear functional? So what does this say? That integral a to b f plus g d alpha is same as integral f d alpha plus integral g d alpha. And second thing says that integral k f d alpha is same as k times integral a to b f d alpha. Right. So in other words, if you take this map f going to integral a to b f d alpha, or suppose you define phi f is equal to integral a to b f d alpha, then phi is a linear functional on this vector space. Okay, so basically proving these properties of this integral is basically showing that the integration is a linear functional on this vector space of all integrable functions. Okay. All right. Now, since there are three functions involved here, f, g and f plus g, and whenever we want to talk about the integration, obviously upper sums, lower sums are going to come into picture, and so we have to discuss the upper sums, lower sums of three different functions. So we need some notations for this big mi, small mi, etc. Okay, so let us start with this. Okay, let us say that suppose I'll call this function h. Let h be equal to f plus g. Then we will have to talk about the upper sums corresponding to the function h, corresponding to the function f, and corresponding to the function g. Okay, all right. Suppose let us say that, okay, we'll have, suppose I call this mi as the supremum of let us say hx from x in hx for x in xi minus 1 to xi. I will need similar numbers for corresponding to f and corresponding to g, right? So let us say, suppose I denote this by mi star as supremum of fx, same thing, x is in xi minus 1 to xi, and mi double star as supremum of fx in, not fx, or gx. Or same thing again, x varying with the interval xi minus 1 to xi. Okay. Can we see obvious relationship between this mi, mi star and mi double star? What is that? Mi must be less than or equal to mi star plus mi double star. Okay. That is, so we can say that this mi must be less than or equal to mi star plus mi double star. What does it say about the upper sums? We can say that from this it follows that upper sum of H must be less than or equal to upper sum of F, because all that you are doing is that multiplying each of this number by delta alpha and taking the sum. Okay? So we can say that this implies that UPH alpha is less than or equal to UPF alpha plus UPG alpha. Okay. Remember, we are going to use that same method to prove that H is integrable. Okay. What is the method? That given epsilon, we will produce a partition P such that UP H alpha minus LP H alpha is less than epsilon. That is the idea. Okay. 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 So, what we can do now is that okay. Now this is true for every partition P. Whatever be the partition, that upper sum of H is less than or equal to upper sum of F plus upper sum of G, that is true for every partition. Okay, but we know that F and G are integrable. Okay, we know that F and G are integrable. So what we can say is that given any epsilon, I can find a partition. Suppose I call it partition P. Okay, let us start with epsilon. Okay, let us start with an epsilon bigger than 0. What is the aim? Our aim is to produce a partition P, okay, such that for that particular partition, U of H, UPH alpha minus LPH alpha, that should be less than epsilon, okay. That is the aim. Okay. But we know that such a thing can be done for F and G. Such partitions can be found for F and G. So we shall use that fact first. Okay. Let us first stick to the upper sums. One can say that. There exists a partition, suppose I call it partition P1, okay. There exists partition okay. See here we are going to have the several partitions and we are going to use the thing that we have shown earlier, that whenever you take a refinement, the upper sums decrease and lower sums increase. Okay, so we'll find a partition corresponding to F, corresponding to G, and then take something which is common refinement of both. Okay. So we can say there exists a partition P1 such that okay, we know that F and G are integrable. So integral is nothing but the infimum of these upper sums. Okay. In fact, that is what we had called upper integral, but when the function is integrable, those two things are same. So I can say that I can find some partition such that the difference between the integral and the upper sum is less than epsilon or epsilon by 2 or epsilon by 4, whatever we want. Okay, that is what we can do. Okay, so I can say there exists a partition P1 such that UP1F alpha minus integral A to B F d alpha. This is less than okay. I don't remember. Okay, let us start with epsilon by 4. Okay. If we require, we shall change that epsilon by 4 to epsilon by 3 or 6 or whatever we require. Okay. Right. This can be done. Okay. Okay. Then one can say that similarly there exists a partition P2 such that upper sum UP1 G alpha is less than integral. Okay, I can rewrite this inequality. I can bring this integral to the other side. Okay, that is convenient. Okay, instead of writing like this, I shall say that this upper sum is less than this integral plus epsilon by 4. Okay, and similarly this upper sum is less than integral g d alpha plus epsilon by 4. Okay, no, this was P2, right? Okay. Now consider the partition P1 union P2. Consider the partition P1 union P2. For that partition, both of these inequalities should be satisfied. Okay, right? So, okay. Suppose I call that partition now P3. Okay. Okay. Let P3 be equal to P1 union P2. Okay. Then what we want to say is that then u p3 f alpha, this is less than or equal to u p1 f alpha, and that is less than integral a to b f d alpha plus epsilon by 4. Okay. And similarly also u p3 g alpha, this is less than or equal to, since p3 is also a refinement of p2, okay, this is less than or equal to u p3 g alpha, and that is less than integral a to b g d alpha plus epsilon by 4. Okay, all right. Now you look at u p3 h alpha. Okay, right. We have seen earlier that for any partition, u p h alpha is less than or equal to u p f alpha plus u p g alpha. Okay, so u p3 h alpha, that should be less than or equal to u p3 f alpha plus u p3 g alpha. Okay, that is, this should be less than or equal to u p3 f alpha plus u p3 g alpha. Okay. And this is less than integral a to b f d alpha plus epsilon by 4, and this is less than integral a to b g d alpha plus epsilon by 4. So their sum should be less than this plus epsilon by 2. Okay, so this should be less than integral a to b f d alpha plus integral a to b g d alpha plus epsilon by 2. Okay. Okay, so do you agree up to this? Okay, all right. Okay, now whatever we have done for the upper sums, is it clear that we can do a similar thing for the lower sums? Okay, right. What is the obvious changes here? You will take small mi star and small mi double star, and the inequalities will be reversed. Okay, small mi will be bigger than or equal to small mi star plus, that is, in other words, lower sum of h alpha will be bigger than or equal to lower sum of f alpha plus lower sum of g alpha. Okay, and all, so everything that you have done in a similar way, you can do everywhere inequalities will be reversed. Okay, for example, this LP1 f alpha will be bigger than integral a to b f d alpha minus epsilon by 4. Okay, right. Okay, so one can say that following a similar method, you can find a partition, you can find a partition such that for that partition lower sum is bigger than this number minus epsilon by 2. Okay, right. So I shall skip those details, do that on your own to convince yourself. Okay, I will say that in a similar way we can find a partition, we can find a partition. Okay, now suppose I call that partition P4 such that lower sum of with respect to this P4 H alpha, lower sum with respect to this P4 H alpha is bigger than integral a to b f d alpha plus integral a to b g d alpha minus epsilon by 2. Okay. Okay. So again we go, is this clear? Okay. So then again we go back to the same technique. We have partition P3 for which u p 3 is less than this number plus epsilon by 2, and here we have partition p 4 such that this is bigger than this number minus epsilon. If this were the same partition, we could immediately say that this minus this is less than epsilon, okay, but that is not the that is not the case, because so, but we know that how to deal with such things, okay. Just take the union of the two, so that will be a common partition for both, common refinement for both, and so that both the inequalities are satisfied, okay. So I'll just okay, this statement I require, so I'll go back here, okay. So let P be equal to what are partition, we have P3 and P4, okay, P3 union P4, and we want to show that this P is the required partition, okay. P is a refinement of both P3 and P4, and we know that for the refinements upper sums decrease and lower sums increase. So okay, let me just write it here, okay. So I can say that this U P H alpha is less than or equal to this, and hence less than or equal to less than this plus epsilon by 2, okay. Oh sorry, this should have been everywhere this should have been, no that is correct, no? Yes
sir, third line,
this line,
third line
here,
P2 come on sir, second in the middle, UP2G alpha is saying,
okay, this should be, that's right, because we have used the fact that P3 is a refinement of C. Okay, then where were we? We are using that P is P3 union P4, okay. So UP H alpha is less than or equal to UP3 H alpha, and similarly lower sums increase, so lower sum with respect to P should be bigger than or equal to lower sum with respect to P4, okay. So we can also say that LP H alpha is bigger than or equal to LP4 H alpha, and so that is bigger than all these things, okay. All right, okay, then u p h alpha minus l p h alpha, this is less than what, this minus this, right, this less than, okay. So when you subtract, these two numbers will get cancelled, so this will be epsilon by 2 minus, so this is less than epsilon, okay. Okay, all right, okay. So what we have, so this shows that this implies that H is Riemann-Stieltjes integrable, okay. It shows this first thing, okay. And though it doesn't show immediately this, okay, you can observe that we have done whatever is required for showing this, okay. We have done whatever is required for showing this. Once we show that H is Riemann-Stieltjes integrable, okay, it means that integral H d alpha exists. It means that integral H d alpha exists, and that is less than or equal to any upper sum, okay. That is less than or equal to any upper sum, and also bigger than or equal to any lower sum, okay. So but we already have one partition for which we, okay, we have not only proved this, in fact we have proved many much more than this, okay. We have in fact proved that u p h alpha is less than or equal to this number plus epsilon by 2, right, okay. Okay, so okay, let us just recall that, okay. So once we know that h is Riemann-Stieltjes integrable, it means that this number exists, integral a to b h d alpha exists, okay. That is something we already proved, okay. And moreover, this number must be less than or equal to any upper sum. This number must be less than or equal to any upper sum. So that means in particular, this is less than or equal to this u p h alpha, okay. this must be less than or equal to u p h alpha, okay, all right. But we already know that this p has the property that u p h alpha is less than or equal to integral a to b f d alpha plus integral a to b g d alpha plus epsilon by 2, okay. That is something that we know, okay. So that means this is less than integral a to b f d alpha plus integral a to b g d alpha plus epsilon by 2, okay. What is more, we also know that this is an integral must be bigger than or equal to any lower sum, okay, must be bigger than or equal to any lower sum. So this must be in particular bigger than or equal to L p h alpha, okay, all right. And we know that L p h alpha is bigger than or equal to, again, well, let us write, this is bigger than or equal to, I will continue here, it is again the same two number, f d alpha plus integral a to b g d alpha minus epsilon by 2, okay, all right. So what does it mean? That is, this number integral a to b h d alpha, this lies between whatever is this sum of these two number plus epsilon by 2 and this minus epsilon by 2, okay. So what can we say about the difference between this and the sum of these two? Suppose I want to look at this integral a to b h d alpha minus integral a to b, okay, f d alpha plus integral a to b g d alpha. Suppose I want to look at difference between this difference, okay. In fact, we have shown that this difference is less than epsilon by 2, right, okay, because this shows that this minus this number is less than epsilon by 2 and bigger than minus epsilon by 2, okay. So this difference is less than epsilon by 2, okay, but epsilon was arbitrary, remember that, okay. We started with any arbitrary epsilon, and for that epsilon we have shown that the, if you take this number and whatever is there on the, that is difference between left hand side and right hand side is less than epsilon by 2, okay, for any arbitrary epsilon. So the only way in which this can happen is that those numbers must coincide, okay, those numbers must coincide, and that gives this result, okay. That is, if the two functions are Riemannian disintegrable, their sum is also Riemannian disintegrable, okay, and integral of f plus g is same as integral of f plus integral of g, is that clear, okay. Then what I would say is that the proof of this is also exactly similar, there are no new ideas involved here, okay. In fact, it is even simpler, because see here what was the whole idea, relating to the upper sum of this f plus g with upper sum of f and upper sum of g, and similarly for the lower sums. Here you have to do only for the function k times f, okay, and that is very easy, okay, because you can say that upper sum of k, that is, you can easily show this, that for any partition p, u p f alpha is, see, we want k times f, we want k times f. Of course, you will have to make a slight you have to be little bit careful here, okay, you have to make the cases when k bigger than or equal to 0, k less than or equal to 0, etc., okay. If k is equal to 0, there is nothing to be proved. K is equal to 0, there is nothing to be proved, because it is a constant function 0 and we know that that is integrable. If k is bigger than 0, okay, then we can say this, if k is bigger than 0, then upper sum of k times f, this is same as k times u p f alpha, okay, right. And similarly one can say about the lower sums, okay. And so you can prove this at least when k is positive, you can prove this at least when k is positive, okay. If k is negative, what will happen is that this will be k times the lower sum of this. If k is negative, upper sum of p k f alpha will be nothing but k times lower sum with respect, and similarly for the lower sum, okay. And again you can basically use the same technique, right. So no new ideas are involved to prove this, okay. So that is why I will skip this proof, okay. Basically all that you need to do is, given epsilon, you have to produce a partition P such that for that partition the difference between upper sum and lower sum is less than epsilon, okay. And then this part you can prove in the similar way, okay, using this, okay. We will stop with that for today, okay. There are many other properties of this type, and those we shall see in the next class.